toxicity, awareness, patient education, recognition, grade of toxicity management, and guidelines, as mentioned before. And I will start with you because I'm the one who's dealing with patients in every day. And so I was speaking about reality. We have a lot of experience with immuno-oncology treatment. We had plenty of patients as well. So we had some reality and some experience regarding the toxicity and how to see our patients. So I will start first with one of the cases. He is a 78 years gentleman. He was referred to my clinic with left lung mass. It was 6 by 5 by 5 centimeter upper lobe invading the pleura and left pulmonary artery and aorta as well. PET scan revealed multiple hepatic and bone lesions, and bronchoscopy and biopsy were carried out and revealed adenocarcinoma, grade 3, EGFR wild, ALK, and ROS1. And the patient, he was PD-L1 70%. Before, as you know, all the cases of lung cancer is a routine. We are usually, we're treating the patient based on morphology, and then when we had driver mutations, EGFR and ALK and ROS1, it's changing the era. And now we are in the era of the immunotherapy, and so PD-L1 is one of the criteria for the diagnosis, and it's a routine as well. So patient was elected for pembrolizumab therapy, and all investigations for him, it was normal and echo as well. Patient has no comorbidities and remarkable medical history and family history as well. So the patient presented to the clinic, and I had to discuss with him the strategy of the treatment. He was a little bit upset, and I was astonishing that when I'm telling him that you receive immunotherapy, and he was telling me no. Patient has some experience with his wife because she was diagnosed with breast cancer and she received chemotherapy. And he watched her sick all the time, and he was telling me, don't worry, doctor, I know that it's all coming with the vomiting, diarrhea, and sickness the whole day. So I pointed out that immunotherapy treatment and side effects are different. And this is really important issue. When we discuss the patient's strategy, usually we have to tell them everything. We try to tell them what the stages, what the sequence, and what is the treatment in favor, what we have to them. And even when I'm trying to tell him about the treatment, he was telling me, why you are not giving me chemotherapy? So I told him that based on the recent data, it was superior to the chemotherapy, and maybe down the road, maybe we'll use chemotherapy. So this is the point. And the second issue, I told him that it's always coming with side effects, nothing perfect. And we have to always to describe what is really you are seeing in common base and what is uncommon. However, for the immunotherapy, as it was mentioned to you earlier, that for all immunotherapy, you cannot have an expectations. It can come during, it can come acute, it can come late, and even after patient finishing his treatment. So as Mr. Mohammed mentioned, prevention, anticipate, detect, treat, monitor. This is the cycle you have to put in your consideration. So prevention is the recognition of the side effects and your medication. When you are giving the medication to the patient, it's very favorable to know what is the type, whether it's chemotherapy, it's hormonal therapy, or immunotherapy. I had a lot of nurses who are there helping me in the clinic. They come in and ask me, is it immunotherapy? It's really worth it? Is it better? Or what's so? And the other issue, that why you are not giving the patient target therapy or a combination. So the questions, it's always important, and explanations as well. So again, immune therapy activate the immune system. It's against cancer. So destruction of the tumor. However, it's against normal tissue, so this is the side effects. Can we affect other parts of the body? So early treatment, better outcome, recognition of the grade one, or when the patient they are calling us. So when the patient they are usually, I'm telling them, so when I'm seeing the patient for the first time and we're giving them the treatment, I'm telling them that immunotherapy can have anything for you. You can have some reaction during the when you're receiving the treatments. You can have even when you have some diarrhea or something. So if you are taking bad food or you are eating outside and you are not feeling unwell, so if during the day you are not getting any better, please call. And always when they are calling our nurse. So usually you are the first station for the patient, so information is really important to you. So do we have a predictor for the response and toxicity? We have a predictor for the response, the PD-L1 and mutational burden, and smoking is considered predictor of response. This is why when I gave it the patient, it was based on the PD-L1, the patient was 70%. This is why it was ranking as a first line. However, in the second line, it's a different issue. It can be without PD-L1 as well, but it depending. So I will not go for the details for this. So the main point that we do have a predictor for using the medication, for predicting the response. And this is the PD-L1. Usually we are detecting the PD-L1 in the tissue so far. And when you are looking here, the first one here, the brownish one means the patient is positive. So when we are asking in the clinic for the patient with PD-L1, this is what we look. When we see come to you that 1% or 70%, and we wanted you, as you are very expert in the lab, we wanted also when you are checking the radiological and the lab, we wanted you as well to know what does this mean, the percentage of the patient. So if it's high, more than 50% or equal, it can be candid for a PEMPO, or if it's lower, it will be a different story and we can use it as a medication or combination. Again, I will not go for this. So it will be predictor of the response, as you can see in the graph. As I mentioned before, we have about five categories of the PD-1 and PD-L1. There is no much difference between them. However, there is some difference regarding the toxicity, and it's almost the same indications in both of them. Again, the immunotherapy, it can affect any part of the body from the head to toe, as mentioned. So the symptoms is really important. So patients, when they are calling you, when we have chemotherapy and patient is having headache for a patient receiving chemotherapy or patient with breast cancer, she is a stage 2 disease and she's under chemotherapy, it's considered that you can go ahead and take ibuprofen or take Advil. But for patient who's receiving immunotherapy, you have to be suspicious. Even 5% for the patient, they can have a serious effect. It's a low, but please be suspicious. Low blood count for the patient with chemotherapy, it's very normal. But for the patient with immunotherapy, you have to think about the immune destruction of blood cells. So the issue, not to be overestimating or underestimating, just try to understand the medication and try to understand the side effects as well. How to manage. So again, we don't have a predictor for the toxicity. We have only a predictor for the response. So the toxicity can happen for any patient at any time. And even after finishing the treatment, it can happen. We know that still the medication is still in the body and is still stimulating. So we do have post-response after finishing the treatments or holding. So how to manage side effects and toxicity? It was intensively described to you by the distinguished speakers. So the main point that initially, any patient come to you, we need to have a medical history. So if I'm seeing the patient and you pick information from him that he has no rheumatoid arthritis, which is very common, or patient celiac disease or Addison disease, autoimmune disease by itself, this means this patient, he is very specified and he maybe have problems more than another patient because they have an issue regarding the autoimmune disease. You may be considered during the treatment or patient who is receiving steroids or any immunotherapy otherwise. So also for the patient with organ transplant, we had some patients, as you know, we have plenty of patients with renal transplant, we have patients with liver transplant, and we have HIV patient as well. So this patient categorizes it as a specified patient and should be considered that any complaint for them should be serious until proved otherwise. So history, it's really important. The second is the oral medications. If any patient receive any medications, I know guys that you always putting the list of medications patient when they are coming to the clinic. The main point that sometimes patient have herbal medications. So when they are coming for the second cycle and we found that the liver functions is increasing or the kidney functions, they are increasing, always we have to ask, do you have any? Because we are Not even here, it's even in different countries, they still use the over-counter or other medications other than the immunotherapy. So the information of the medication can change, because if I'm giving the treatment and I found that transaminase is elevated or the creatinine is elevated, I have to be suspicious. Is it nephritis or hepatitis, or this patient because of the, I need to hold the immunotherapy at that day and investigate the patient. So the medications when we use by the patient, it's really important and should be reported. Again, you are second eye and we need your information. You pick it if I miss it. So time to response to the immunotherapy, it's different between one patient to the other. And always we can have rash. The most common side effects we are seeing in the patient is a fatigue. And we seeing the patient in every day. And also because most of our patients, they are not accustomed to the, they are not athletic. They are not have a lot of physical activity. So beside when the community, they are feeling that they are receiving IV infusions or receiving treatments, always they have a psychological burden on them. So the fatigue, it is the commonest side effect I'm seeing in every day, beside of course the other. We don't have a specific treatment for the fatigue. Even it's reported in all the trials before, and even we are seeing in every day. But usually we are encouraging the patient that this treatment, it's not a chemotherapy. It's a stimulating your immune therapy and it's fighting cancer. So the physical activity, and it will supposed to go down, it will not supposed to stay the same. Sometimes it's the psychological elements and telling him that this statement, it can affect their performance and they can tolerate. So, do different treatment for one to the other. Nivo and Pimpo, about 10 to 15 patients, they may have side effects. EP, it's the highest, and comparable with the combinations. Of course, we still didn't use the combination in our institute, but it will be later because it's now can be as a front, and also it's approved in melanoma as well. We don't have much melanoma. However, when you are doing combination, you can see that clearly. Is there a difference between Pembo, Nivo, and Atezo? There is Pelletel from Spain, he did a comparative study regarding the immunotherapy types, and there was some difference between the PD-1 and PD-L1, and the toxicity profile is a little bit higher with Nivo-Pembo comparable, however, it's not much. And you can see the pneumonitis is even higher in the Nivo, however, the number of patients we cannot rely, and it can be at any patients. This is just only to give you a signal that how about the difference between the chemotherapy and the immunotherapy as a toxicity profile. Again, if you are doing two immunotherapy, of course the toxicity profile will be higher, especially on the transaminase and colitis and hypothyroidism as well. So be expecting that if you are doing combination, it will be higher as a matter of side of toxicity. So is it manageable? Yes, it is manageable. The first one, you are doing this and on daily basis on the CDU, and so you have the patients. So infusion reaction, if it's mild, you can just stop the treatment and give steroids and give diphenhydramine as usually you are doing. If it is severe, you need to call your physician and you need to stop the treatment, and we have to make it slowly and to give a try again. So we are not stopping the treatment because it's once. We need to just try it again and to make it slow infusion about for 10 minutes. And then we have to monitor the patient, because if it's serious, we'll not be able to give it again. And the main issue is that we don't have that. If you have one reaction for one immunotherapy, we are not able to give the other, especially for the severe one. So the second, it was mentioned before about the skin toxicity as well. We have grades between rash to bullous and cellulitis, and it's all depending on the degree. And so usually we start with the topical if it's mild and we are not stopping the treatment. If it's bullous or vitiligo, this means that you need to give oral steroid and antihistaminic. Again, it was mentioned before by Dr. Anagwa and Mr. Muhammad as well, that the NSA guidelines give us a hint And it's important to have a guidelines between your hands, so at least you can have a common language regarding the CTC and the degree. So nobody can stop the treatment comparable that the patient has mild rash. So for the severe cases, we can stop the treatment for a while. And it's always a common question for the patient. If I will stop the treatment, I will not return again. It depends on the degree and it depends on the severity of the medication. And we have to know that the medication stays in the body about 90 days. So in severe one or in moderate one, you need to slow down before starting and you need to start slowly because it's a serious effect. It's an autoimmune. So ocular inflammation, uveitis and conjunctivitis, it's one of the reported manifestations as well. Again, it can be at any part of the body from head to toe. So the uveitis, you need to be involved with the ophthalmologist. And this is really important. I'm not treating the patient alone. I need to involve the people with me. So the patient with the skin manifestations, I need to involve the dermatology with me. So the patient with uveitis or conjunctivitis, I need to start the treatment for the patient with eye drops and start with oral medications and send the patient to ophthalmologist so they can do examination of the eye and do a fundus examination as well to slit lamp. So team, leader, MDT, and you need to involve the other specialists with you. You are not treating the patient alone. Gastrointestinal, it's one of the commonest. Colitis, it's very vague because any type of the food, the patients, they are not feeling well, bloating, cramps, diarrhea, and sometimes we are now using the immunotherapy as a second or the fourth or fifth line in colorectal cancer. So most of these patients, they are accustomed for the diarrhea from the chemotherapy. And so the point that for colitis for this patient, it's different that when you are treating patient with colorectal disease, comparable with patient with lung cancer, and she's treating the treatment for the first or the second line. So she's a lung cancer patient, and she is calling repeatedly, I do have a colitis, or I do have a pain and the diarrhea, and it's not getting better. You need to call her that she need to come to the ER because the patient, she need to be evaluated. And we have picked some patient who had colitis, and we did for them endoscopy and biopsy as well. And we usually for the mild, we start with the loperamide and Lamotil. And for the patient with grade 2 and 3, we are giving IV steroids. And I will come to the point of steroids later, that it's always a point of question from you folks that if the steroids are affecting our outcome or not. And it was an important issue as well. Again, it's all in NC guidelines. You can just Google and you can download the guidelines for you. It's very accessible. Here, one of the commonest is the thyroid gland. We usually, when we are doing the investigations for the patient, we are doing the CBC lab and creatinine and everything. And once we started the immunotherapy for the patient, usually we are doing T3 and T4 and TSH. So for the patient who have initially, because it's very common here in Saudi Arabia, that the patient with Graves' disease or patient with hypothyroidism, you need to have a baseline information initially, or it's affecting by, or you the patient needs supplements. Because if you are giving the treatment for the patient and she has hypo or hyperthyroidism, it will be affecting her outcome for sure. And some of the patient, if you are giving overdose, it can be causing palpitation and cardiac problems, and should be monitored. One of the common, the rarest one, and it's recorded, but it's really serious because it can pass without unnoticed. It's the hypophysitis. It's a headache, and most of the patient you cannot recognize because when it's bigger, it can cause visual disturbance when it's started to be have a problem. However, you can just note it by the hormonal profile, but it's missing from because it's uncommon. So for patient who is coming with confusion, visual disturbance, fatigue, hallucination, insomnia, and loss of appetite, it's all vague symptoms. Just only we can do the hormonal profile and just be a reminder. Once the patient proven by the MRI or the hormonal profile, you can call for the neurologist and you can start with the intravenous steroids for the patient on hormonal replacement. And this is will be one of the patients who had Guillain-Barré syndrome. He was one of my patients. He was a Hodgkin lymphoma, and he received second, first line of nivolumab after a failure of brentuximab. The main point that the patient with Guillain-Barré syndrome, you cannot recognize it clearly because the patient, he presented with neurological symptoms, and when you did the MRI for the patient and MRI the whole vertebrae as well, it came all negative. So it's mainly GPS you can by suspicious. And it's polyneuropathy, and it's serious. You have to stop the medication, and you have to start IVIG for the patient, and you have to call for the neurology. It's uncommon. We treated almost about 140 patients. However, we had one patient, and this keep you that you have to be in track, and you have to be suspicious. So the second one is the adrenalites, which is, again, check the hormonal profile of the patient, and it can be serious effect as well. One of the serious element that you have to be put in your mind is the nephritis. And I had one patient who had the nephritis, and it was grade one. This patient, he was lung cancer. And the patient initially, he was known to have followed by the nephrology team, and he started in with the chemotherapy first, Alimta carboplatin, and they will progress, and he received second line immuno. The main point that the Alimta can affect the kidney, and also when you are giving the treatment. So sometimes when the patient have a potentiality to have the side effects, you need to know. So his creatinine was going up. And the patient, he was, we sent him to the nephrology, and we had a biopsy, and the biopsy came with nephritis. We hold the treatment for a while and give the patient steroids. And he responded very well. Again, multidisciplinary team, it's really important. I'm not treating a patient with immunotherapy alone. I have to involve other specialty. And for the adverse events, again, the skin, the highest, followed by the gastrointestinal, followed by the endocrine, and you need to pick it as soon as possible, please. This graph may show up about the onset, and again, the skin, the first one to start, and followed by the gastrointestinal, hepatic, pulmonary, endocrine, and renal. However, it can be upside down. There is no clue, but this is the commonest based on the data presented. So, important questions. We have important questions in the clinic. How soon after starting immunotherapy should I expect side effects? Anytime. Some side effects typically occur early, rash, and later, like thyroid, and it can be the same. Do my symptoms, this is a question by the patient, by the way. Do my symptoms represent on immunotherapy side effects? 24-hour rule. Okay, so give yourself a day or less than a day, and if it's not going better, you need to call or need to come to the ER. Different than baseline rule. And important questions about the steroids. If I'm using, because the steroids, they are suppressing the immune system. So you are guys giving me steroids. This means that it will maybe affect my risk, its mandate. But when Weber presented this in ASCO 2015, that the patient who is receiving steroid doesn't affect the duration of response or the outcome. So it can be safe. However, when we are talking about serious events for the patients or side effects, the first priority is the patient condition, so we have to give them the treatment, and of course, his outcome is really important. But we have to give him a base, not a patient who is coming with grade one skin rash, you can give him oral steroids. This is totally nonsense. You can just, our patient coming with diarrhea, and you are giving him steroids starting, you can just give loperamide and give a space to see the patient, how they are doing, flagyl and ciprofloxacin if needed. So, and you can see the outcome of the patient. Don't be in a hurry to start the steroid for the patient, and don't mix up between the grades. Do side effects mean the drug is working? It's very important questions, because in some medications, when you are giving the treatment specifically for the target therapy, there is some data that when you are using the anti-EGFR, sometimes with the skin manifestations, it just gives you an interpretation of the patient. There is no rule. some patients, they have side effects and they are not responding well, and patients have a lack of side effects and they're responding very well. So there is no clue about this. Because most of the time, even some of the nurses, they were coming and ask me. So these questions also can be asked to you by the patient. You are involved with the patient on a daily basis about the side effects, about the outcome, and it's not all the time you have to convey their questions to us. You need to have the information and you need to have an interpretation of what we are giving and the understanding totally. Sure. I'm your co-chair. Okay. My side effects are much better. I'm anxious to restart therapy. Again, as I told you, nivolumab is taken to target at least 90 days after a single dose. So you need to calm down before restarting the treatment because the immune memory. So how to monitor the patient? I will go fast regarding this. I had one of my colleague nurse when she came to me that the patient is responding very well. However, when I checked his scans, that he is disease progression. So I told her that once we have a subjective improvement in the patient, usually with the immunotherapy, as you can see here in the scans, you can see that the patient initially have the lesion and then the patient, there is a resolution. This is what we call, because immune therapy, it's a stimulating of the immune system. It's an aggregation of the T lymphocytes. And so you can just increasing the size. And we have what we call the IR RECIST criteria. So this is for an example for the patient who was presented in ESMO last year, was a patient who was initially have a disease progression. And then the patient, he responding fantastic. The comparable between the chemotherapy and you guys, know this very well. I will just only summarize that the NCI guidelines, it was mentioned before, and this is the baseline you have to do for all the patients. And our key points, rapid diagnosis and treatment intervention for optimal and cover and prevention of the patient. Early discontinuation of steroids may increase the risk of relapse or progression, so don't be in hurry to stop, taper the steroids, reinitiation of treatment can be possible, and decision to restart is not always clear. And take home message, immunotherapy side effects can affect any part of the body, even if it's minor. Side effects can occur even after therapy has ended. Keeping close with the healthcare team is crucial. We want to hear from, this is very important. This is the ESMO guidelines as well, and we love our nurse. Thank you very much.